Obeying the Gospel, June 22nd. Scriptural teaching about God's election. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Romans 8:33. To elect is to choose. So if we were talking about our salvation by God, and we said that it's a matter of His election or choosing, what would we mean? John Calvin, and various others before him, argued that before God created the world, He chose which individuals would be saved. Yet it goes far beyond the truth concerning God's election in our passage in Romans 8:33 to teach that God unconditionally elected some individuals to salvation. Each of these terms makes a difference. Let's take them in reverse order. First, salvation. The Scriptures teach that before the boys were born, God chose Jacob and not his twin brother Esau to father the family through whom the Messiah would come into the world. Romans 9:10-12. So yes, God did choose some persons to play specific roles in His plan to bring about salvation. But that's a very different thing than choosing those persons to be eternally saved or lost. Second, individuals. Paul spoke of the Colossians as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, Colossians 3, verse 12. Salvation is surely a matter of God's choice, and His divine prerogative is where the emphasis should always be kept. It was God who chose whom He would save. But what He chose was a class of people defined by a criterion, the obedience of faith, as Paul calls it in Romans 1, verse 5. This group is open to all who will obey. No one is barred by an eternal, unchangeable edict of God. But third, unconditional. In the New Testament, people decided whether they would obey the gospel or not, Acts 2, 40 and 41, for example. Yet without any conditions that can be accepted or rejected, the gospel call is not really an invitation. Indeed, the whole enterprise of evangelism is meaningless if God has ordained who will be saved and salvation is not contingent on anyone's decision as to the gospel's requirements. If the Bible teaches anything about God, it teaches that He acts with justice. He shows no partiality, Acts 10, verse 34. But if Calvinism is true, T.W. Brents was correct when he said that God cannot possibly be considered a fair and righteous judge. Consider Brent's remarks. But if the doctrine is true, that before the foundation of the world was laid, according to an immutable and eternal purpose of His own, without any foresight of faith, good works, or anything else in man, God unconditionally elected some men and angels to eternal life, and at the same time foreordained the residue to dishonor and eternal wrath, then we know not how to avoid the conclusion that He is a respecter of persons.